this is not a great time. I'm at work.
No. This is about us.
Oh no. Do that I can't.
How do I say this? Alfonsus, he is a man, and he can perform.
Am I not man enough for you? It's my favorite hat. It means so much to me. How could you do this?
I'm sorry, Alfonsus. I hope you would understand.
How am I supposed to understand? You slept with my colleague.
Oxford graduate, 1978, Alfonso Wainwright. Oh yeah, the hat looks good. Alfonso Wainwright. Alfonso Wainwright. Ah yes, Alfonso. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. My name is Alfonso Wainwright, PhD.
That looks good.
Introducing Dr. Alfonsus Wainwright, respected academic and intellectual to all, with the sole exception of his wife, Linda Wainwright. Toppled from his high podium, the once great Wainwright now wallows in emotional mires and often teeters on the absolute brink of madness and insanity. Tonight's phone call with Linda has left Wainwright grasping in vain for any reason to live. And he is unsure what he will do with his wretched self after seeing his final patient for the night. And here we find tonight's patient, Paul Jacob Atchison, an unwashed troglodyte of a man. Few have been as ambitious as he in his absolute lacking of any ambition. Tortured and plagued by incessant delirium, Mr. Atchison has finally made the decision to seek professional help. The stage is set for Delusions of Grandeur!
In.
Dr. Wainwright, I'm so sorry I'm late. I overslept.
It's all right, not a problem.
Paul Atchison?
Dr. Wainwright, you seem to know my name already.
Yes, Dr. Wainwright.
It's your first time here at therapy?
This is my second time trying something new.
All right, well, I suppose let's get to it.
The usual setup, is this me?
Yep, that's you.
All right, here we go. You mind if I... Where can I put this?
Anywhere you'd like. Okay.
Thank you. So, just lie down like this?
Yep, that's, get nice and comfy.
The last guy had two chairs, actually. We sat like this and we looked at each other.
Why are you here today? What makes you come to me?
That's sort of a difficult question because it's one that I would like answered myself. I guess in essence, at night I go to sleep, you know, like any other person.
Mm-hmm.
But then I am haunted by these vivid dreams, these delusions. And when I wake up, I'm exhausted. I feel like I haven't slept at all. And the whole day long, I'm just haunted by these dreams I've had.
How is this affecting your mood daily?
Oh, it makes me ornery and antsy. It makes me real restless, you know? It's a real problem.
Oh, I understand that. What do you think the root of this problem is?
I don't know. Maybe an unsatisfied life? Should I be looking at you?
You can look wherever you'd like.
Okay.
Eye contact is not necessary.
Does it unnerve you?
Not quite.
Okay. I'm gonna look here.
Sounds good. So tell me about these delusions. Give me a specific instance.
Well, just last week, actually, I've been reading a lot recently, so... I actually, in my dream, I wrote the next American novel, the next great American novel.
What was this novel about?
I don't really remember. You know, so much of the dream was just I was writing and I was mad, you know? Have you ever tried to make something?
Oh, I've tried many times.
Yeah, and you know how hard it is when you try and you try and you just... You're not getting anywhere. It makes a man mad!
Oh, I see.
I'm sorry.
Not a problem, this is a safe space.
I get so carried away.
You're allowed to convey your emotions here.
Okay. I feel so mad! I just feel so mad, you know? I feel really angry!
Oh, I got you there. So this book that you wrote in this dream, tell me about it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's the year is 1950, and you know, the literary greats, they're going. You know, John Steinbeck's there, Hemingway's there, you know,
Michael Crichton.
Michael Crichton?
I think he wrote Jurassic Park.
Michael Crichton, he's 1950, he writes Jurassic Park.
Yep.
You know, and I'm right there with them, you know? I've just returned from an expedition in Morocco, actually.
Full circle?
Yes, full circle. A real comeback, you know? And I'm out there and I'm in the jungle. And it's there that I find my inspiration. And I realized that my dream is to become an author.
So I'm out on assignment for discovery. This was before I became the great American novelist. And I'm actually looking for the last of the...
The velociraptors.
Yes. And I was in the jungles of the Amazon on assignment for National Geographic. And I was looking for the last of the velociraptors.
The last velociraptor? Are you sure you're not associating with our earlier conversation about Michael Crichton in Jurassic Park?
No.
And while we were unsuccessful, and I recorded a great deal of footage...
I like the dramatic angle, like, he's a great man, he's out in the jungle.
Oh, that's like some dramatic lighting right there.
I actually found the meaning of my life. I had an epiphany. It was dark out, and we were on assignment, and we did not find the velociraptor, but it was as if God had whispered into my ear, you are a genius. You will become the next great novelist. And so I returned to New York City
beating heart of the literary world, and I began to write.
I hope you don't mind if I consume some peanuts.
Well, can you believe that this shit cost $7, maybe even $8? I went to Cumbie's there.
Uh-huh.
And there's a tag underneath that said $1.99. I was like, shit, way too good to be true. And I got rung up at the checkout, $7.99. It's an absolute ripoff. Could just go to Morocco and pick my own peanuts.
Want some peanuts?
Not really. Oh!
Want some peanuts?
Oh, good lord. No, thank you. Where did you say you did your doctorate?
Oxford or something.
That was brilliant.
Pick my own peanuts. That's not where peanuts come from.
So, what happened next?
Well, as a matter of fact, in this dream, I get back to New York City alive. I do not find the Velociraptor. I'm shunned in the National Geographic community. And I know now that there's no way back for me. I cannot become a photojournalist or a filmmaker or a documentarian. I must go forward with my dream of writing the next American novel. And so I begin to read, and I begin to write.
If you really want to hear about it, the first thing you'll probably want to know is where I was born and what my lousy childhood was like and how my parents were occupied and all before they had me and all that David Copperfield kind of crap. But I don't feel like going into it if you want to know the truth. In the first place, that stuff bores me, and in the second place, my parents would have about 2 hemorrhages apiece if I told anything pretty personal about them. They're quite touchy about anything like that, especially my father. They're nice and all, I'm not saying that, but they're also touchy as hell. Besides, I'm not going to tell you my whole goddamn autobiography or anything.
As Gregor Santa woke one morning from uneasy dreams, he found himself transformed in his bed into an enormous insect. Be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them, to die to sleep no more and by a sleep to say we end, the heartache and the 1,000 natural shocks that flesh is heir to, 'tis a consummation. Call me Ishmael. Some years ago, never mind how long precisely, having little or no money in my purse, and nothing particular to interest me on shore, I thought I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. It is a way I have of driving off the speed.
Pull yourself together, man. Put your thinking cap on.
Exactly. And then I woke up. You see why I'm so angry all the time?
I do. I mean, it makes sense to me.
And that's not the only time that it happens. It's every single time one of these dreams happens. The same thing happens. Every single time.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
These are damn good.
These are good. Where did you say you got them?
I come from a farm or something. That's kind of a ripoff, though. I wouldn't even buy them.
Mm-hmm.
$7, man? Way too much.
$7, really?
No, I can't fucking believe it.
Wow.
It's nuts. So anyway, I'm noticing that a common theme throughout all of these dreams, huh?
Yeah.
You see it?
No.
Do you see what I'm getting at?
No.
You're getting played, son. Every single one of these, you're getting ripped off.
You think that's why I'm so angry?
Stealing your ideas, obviously.
Well, maybe when you put it that way, I mean...
That motherfucker Michael Crichton?
Yeah.
What, Jurassic Park? He just stole your shit.
Now that you say it, I mean, I guess I'd never thought of that. What if I had a dream where I didn't get ripped off?
Have you?
Well, there was this one dream, you know, I was in a submarine.
A submarine, you say?
Yeah, and you know, nothing bad happened. I mean, you ever wanted to be in a submarine?
You know what this reminds me of? My wife, Linda.
Oh.
I recently found out, as in right before this session, that she has been fraternizing with my colleague, Dr. Stevenson.
No way, they've been, like, writing a paper together or something?
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a little more deep than that, if you know what I'm saying, but
This
is, I think we can relate here. We're in somewhat of the same boat, the same sub, you know?
You know, may I speak freely here?
Of course.
I feel like, you know, we're two little men in the big world, you know? And guys like us, we gotta stick together, you know? You know, sometimes in those dreams, that submarine, it feels so big, so large, and you know, it's just one man commanding. And that submarine, it's a real big submarine, you know? And I'm a real small man, and you know, one man in a submarine, trying to control the whole thing, I feel like, if I just had another man in that submarine, everything would be alright, and I could overcome that frustration and anger that follows me every day.
I can be the man in the submarine. That is my job here.
The man in the submarine.
The man in the submarine. I can be the man in the submarine.
You can?
I can come in the submarine with you. You know what this calls for?
What?
A celebration.
I agree. What are you suggesting? My, oh my.
Oh yes.
That is a fine sight to behold.
Islay single malt whiskey.
Aged 10 years.
Ah, yes. Beautiful, beautiful.
To friendship, old sports.
To friendship, old boy. The taste of peat is immaculate.
Quite.
Shall we?
We shall.
The taste of peat is immaculate.
Quite.
Shall we?
We shall.
Alright, Powell. We're in the submarine. Walk me through this. How do we defeat your trauma?
What I need, Alfonso, is for someone to operate the radio. You know, I never wanted this to happen. I always wanted more of a Steve Zissou thing. The Aquatic Life Steve Zissou. Have you ever seen it? I believe it's a Wes Anderson movie. Steve Zissou, I wanted... Steve Zissou. I wanted... You know how they have those two porpoises in the movie? You know, and they follow the ship around? And they do good for the world? That's what I wanted. But instead, war broke out. And now, we're part of the Allied war effort. And we're going underneath Japanese lines. So what I need is a man to operate the radio. Listen for the sonar pings.
Aye, aye, Captain Atchison. I can do that.
You know what, Captain Atchison? This really throws me back to when me and Linda used to listen to the radio.
Uh-huh.
The enemy is six clicks away. How does this make you feel?
I don't feel as angry, you know? I have a friend here to help me. I feel much better. How close are they now?
Three clicks away, sir.
Three clicks, good lord.
You know what we're gonna have to do? We're gonna have to dive.
Gonna have to dive.
Prepare to dive.
Prepare to dive.
Here we go. Ready? And dive!
Sir, I'm releasing 2,000 PSI.
Alfonsus?
Yes?
I'm not sure I've ever been this deep before.
Me neither, sir.
I don't know that she can take it, Alfonsus.
She can always take it. Can always go deeper.
She's coming very close, sir.
How close?
Very close. About 50 feet above us.
Very close, sir.
We can hear them just above us. We have to be very quiet.
How close?
About 30 feet above us. We can hear them talking through the sonar.
All right. Prepare to dive.
Diving further, sir.
We're down to 6,000 feet!
6,000 feet! That sub can't take it! We can't go any further, Alfonso!
We have to go deeper!
I can't go deeper, Alfonso! I can't!
The enemy's closing in!
They're dropping depth charges!
Oh no! Depth charges?
Releasing counter torpedoes!
Time for today's session.
Oh, okay, sure.
I'll see you next week.
Yeah. So, that's it?
That's all the time we got today.
All right, thank you, Dr. Wainwright.
It's been a pleasure, Powell.
It has been a pleasure.
I guess I'll see you next week?
Yeah, I guess I will see you next week.
All right, well, thank you. I've learned a lot today, and I hope you've learned from me.
Yeah, I'm not sure what I've learned, but something inside of me has changed. Yeah, I'll see you next week.
Have a good one.
Here you go.
Thank you. Linda?
Yes?
I'm going to Morocco.
What do you mean, Alfonsus? You can't go to Morocco? What about us? What about me? What about the kids, Alfonsus? You can't go to Morocco, Alfonsus.
You should have thought of that before Dr. Stevenson. Good job today, Alfonso. Good job.
Make a big star out of me. Make a film about a man that's sad and lonely.
Morocco, here we come.
And all I gotta do is act naturally. Well, I bet you I'm gonna be a big star. Might win an Oscar, you can never tell.
That's a wrap.
Gonna make me a big star. Cause I can play the part so well. Well, I hope you come and see me in my movie.
Never
then I know that you won't blame me.